So we're fucking here again. Because someone has gone absolutely crazy in quarantine and decided to attack us with 2 albums in a year. This is unheard of in the Taylor Swift folklore legendariness. I'm too overwhelmed. I have nothing to say. I'm not as surprised as I was the first time around, just because, you know, this has happened again. I feel like this is Groundhog Day. I'm reliving torture one more time. But I'm hoping to get some good fucking food. Evermore is the title of the album. And to me, what I'm thinking is that this is a continuation of folklore. So we're gonna be hearing the same sounds, the same kind of energy, the same narrative, lyrical driven songs. And, you know, I'm hoping for something a little bit different, an element that like sets it apart from folklore and makes it a separate work. So what could that look like? I don't know. It could be an up-tempo collaboration with Haim. I don't know. I literally don't fucking know because the album hasn't arrived. This time around, the first track, Willow, actually has a video. So I will be watching the video first and listening to Willow and reacting to it, and then I will go through the album. Kind of mad at her for doing this, but you know what? We gotta be grateful for the food that we receive, and I'm about to gobble this bitch up. All right, it's happening. We're doing a 13-second countdown right now, which is very on brand for her. Okay, starting where we left off with the cardigan video. This is very safe and sound. I'm like the water when your ship rolls in the night. No, wherever you stray and follow, I'm begging for you to take my hand. Wreck my plans, that's my man. Okay, so these are the kids. This is the 7 reference. As if you were a mythical. Oh my god, she looks so beautiful! Okay, this is the mirror bowl reference where she's standing in this space. I love the aesthetic of this. So is this like a seance situation? Is this her like, I'm coming out as an Illuminati member video? How sweet! Okay. That was really cool. Definitely looks like it's in the same cinematic world as folklore. I like that this song almost is a continuation of Invisible String, which is definitely highlighted in the video with the literal following of the string. She's not one for subtlety. I thought that was really cute. I loved the falsetto. I loved the That's My Man hook. I could live without the 90s lyric. I thought that was kind of stupid. I feel the same way about the lakes. Like, the dating references are annoying because I feel like this world is so timeless. I'm pretty pleased with that. I thought it was really sweet, really cute. It's not gripping me in the way that Cardigan did when I first heard it, but I think that's just because it has a different energy. So now let's get into the fucking album. All right, so track 2 is Champagne Problems. I'm kind of wondering if this is gonna be like a critique of realizing what's important to us in the middle of a quarantine, or if this is gonna be a bop. I'm kind of hoping that it's a little boppy, but it's 4 minutes long, so I'm not sure. Okay, so it's not a bop. It's giving me New Year's Day vibes. Boasting crowds or silent sleepers. Problems. Interesting. This song seems really complex lyrically. I'm not exactly sure what it's about, but it feels like it's kind of in the vein of Getaway Car, like that kind of, or Sad, Beautiful, Tragic, like an ending that was untimely and a regret. That's the energy that I'm getting from this. Definitely not what I thought it was gonna be. Okay, I'm wondering if this is from the perspective of someone who's like married to a politician. That's the energy that I'm getting. There's some sort of, I don't think this is autobiographical at all. This feels very narrative to me, but it's not clicking what exactly it is. Could it be a continuation of the Rebecca Harkness story? It could, but who knows? The vocals are really pretty. That was really beautiful. I'm thinking again that this was not an autobiographical song at all. This really seems like she's telling the story of someone else. And because I'm not Googling or like being in touch with what people are saying about it, I'm not gonna find out. So the confusion that I had when I heard Betty for the first time is here. But it's really narrative and lyrically driven, and it's super intricate, and I really feel like there's a story there. I probably need to listen to it again and read the lyrics to get the full picture. But wow, that was really cool. Next up is Gold Rush. It could be about like a new relationship and the joys that come along with feeling love for the first time. Okay, this is fucking sick and it's giving me gorgeous vibes. The whole like really wanting someone to yourself and not knowing if they're fully committed to you. I like a gold rush. My mind turns your life into folklore. I mean, the legendariness of it all. Wow! Okay, that was my first wow moment of Evermore so far. So my prediction for this album was that it was gonna be a little more happy. It's because the imagery is all in color and folklore is in black and white, so there's a contrast there. But I really liked that. That was definitely kind of building off of the mirror ball energy that we got on Folklore. But this to me is the first thing that feels very different, very kind of like it's carving out a separate path to Folklore, which is what I was really hoping for about this record in particular. I think that there's some amazing storytelling in that song and I need to go back and like process it. But I am getting that first glance feeling of fledgling new connection, kind of that like deep yearning that you have to own someone that you really like. And it's very psychotic, which is perfect for Taylor Swift. I thought I wouldn't be able to say this, but this shit is in different areas. All right, let's do Tis the Damn Season. Now I'm thinking this is gonna be a sad Christmas song, a kind of moody vibe. I'm thinking Christmas is when you were mine, the sequel. Nothing can ever top her, but let's see what's in store for us. If I wanted to know who you were hanging with while I was gone, I would have asked you. It's the kind of cold, box up windshield glass, but I felt it when I passed you. Amazing. This song is about Harry fucking Styles. They dated in the wintertime. I fucking know. This is about her walk through Central Park. Fuck. I escaped it too. Remember how you watched me leave? Love this. You could call it even. You could call me babe for the weekend. I won't ask you the way. If you don't ask me to stay, so I'll go back to LA. So-called friends who write books about me if I ever make it. And wonder about the only soul who can tell which smiles I'm faking. And the heart FML! there's something here about bad friends. Friends that would write a book if I ever make it, but she did make it. So I don't think it's entirely autobiographical, but we know that the Haler tea is there. It's there. It's waiting to be brewed. To leave the warmest bed I've ever known. The warmest bed I've ever known. We could call it even season. We could call it even. You could call me babe for the weekend. Tis the damn season right this time. Oh my god. Oh my god. We got two straight winners. Gold Rush and Tis the Damn Season. Fuck, I was not expecting to like that so much. That is definitely the moody Christmas song that we have been needing in 2020. Is it better than Christmas Is When You Were Mine? I mean, recency bias is saying yes, but historical allegiance is saying no. So I'm not sure, but that was mwah, chef's kiss. That was iconic. It was about Harry Styles. I mean, there were some fictive devices employed, but I mean, come on, the material. I'm kind of shaken and not ready for track 5, which is Tolerated. And I know that she said something in the live chat about linking this back to My Tears Ricochet. And if that's the case, I'm just ready to be attacked, I guess. So I'm just playing. Notice everything you do or don't do. You're so much older and wiser and I wait by the door like I'm just a kid. Use my best colors for your portrait. Okay, is this about a certain John Mayer? Is this about a relationship that she was not emotionally ready for because she was 19 years old? I mean, even with the fancy, I greet you with the battle heroes. Welcome. That was beautiful. This is a classic, heart-wrenching Taylor Swift heartbreak ballad. Whoever said she can't write breakup songs after she got into a relationship was fucking wrong, because listen to the material. I think that this has autobiographical elements, but I think that it is fictional. It sounds like it's about a housewife situation with the polishing plates. Can't imagine Taylor Swift has ever polished a plate, but I do feel like she is intimately familiar with what it's like to be unmatched in emotional maturity in a relationship. We see that with Jake Gyllenhaal and John Mayer, and there is a certain pain towards being more invested in something than someone else is, and that's the kind of energy that I think she's trying to paint in this track five, which is pretty great for a track five, I will say. This does remind me of White Horse in some capacity. I feel like it's the grown-up version of White Horse, but that was heartbreaking. And we're on to track six, which is Nobody, No Crime, featuring Haim. I'm thinking, so I saw that she said something, this is about a true crime documentary or podcast, which is very displeasing to me. But because it's Haim, I feel like it could be upbeat. So let's see. He did what? Ooh, I'm getting country vibes. Oh, we're gonna get a story, girls. Here we go. Her husband's acting different and it smells like infidelity. Okay, I'm getting Carrie Underwood vibes. I'm getting Before He Cheats vibes. And she's using Esty as the name in the song, which is one of the Haim sisters, so that's cool. That ain't my brother on his mom. That ain't my jewelry on our joint account. Anyways, I think he did it, but I just can't prove it. I think he did it, but I just ominous. Okay. I kind of wanted to hit harder.
Good thing his mistress took out a big life insurance policy.
Cause I dug my key into the side. Do you see where I'm going with this? This sounds like Before He Cheats.
They think she did it, but they just can't prove.
I'm hoping we get some vocals in this last chorus.
She did it, but they just can't prove it.
Love. Okay, I love a storytelling moment. I love a different perspective. As you all know, if you watched my last video, I was obsessed with The Last Great American Dynasty. This is giving me that same energy. I'm obsessed. I love it when she takes a story. I love it when she takes different perspectives. I really enjoy a country moment. This was giving me major Carrie Underwood Before He Cheats energy, so I'm thrilled with that. Haim really added a level of like grittiness to it that I thought was really cool. Wow. Okay, this album is shaping up to be something kind of different to Folklore, which is exactly what I wanted it to be. Very pleased. Okay, next is Happiness, which is a 5-minute song, and I just feel like this is gonna be the epiphany of Evermore. It's gonna be too long, it's gonna drag on, it's gonna be boring. So I don't know. Wedding vibes? Okay, I think this is the song that is about marriage story, because she said she was obsessed with divorce while she was reading this. She also said she's never personally experienced it, but like, Andrea and Scott got a divorce.
I was dancing when the music stopped. My fury, you haven't meant to know me.
There's an interesting element coming in here. Like a plucking, like a mandolin. All right, that was boring. I'm sorry, not my favorite. I said this with Epiphany. Sometimes she takes a risk to tell a story that isn't about her life and it goes wrong. And this is one of those scenarios for me. I felt that this just didn't pick up. It took too long. It was a very simple idea that was dragged on for 5 minutes. So she's a skip. This is the first skip so far. There has to be one. So let's move on to track number 8, which is Dorothea. Interested to see what this is about. She said that these characters could have gone to school with Betty and James, so I'm thinking a similar story. Let's find out.
When we were younger, down in the park, honey, making a lark of misery. Being known for who you know, you always know me, Dorothea.
Not a hit. it for me. This is not doing it. I loved Betty, but I loved it as like a one-off experiment. I didn't need Betty the remix slowed down, which is what I'm getting from this. Yikes, that was a snooze. Two snoozes in a row. Not pleased with that, to be honest. Really boring. Didn't like it. Don't know what else to say. Let's do track 9, Coney Island featuring The National. Now, I'm excited about this because I love the atmospheric scenes that The National conjures with their scores. So I'm hoping that Taylor's lyrics add another dimension to that world that they create. I'm making you my centerfold. Over and over, lost again with no surprises, disappointments, close your eyes and it gets colder and colder. The question pounds my head. Yes. It's a lifetime of achievement. I love his voice.
If I pushed you to the edge, but you were too polite to leave me. Close your eyes and it gets colder and colder.
It's cold. I liked that. I thought it was really pretty. Their vocals together are really nice. The harmonies was good. The vocal production was good. I'm starting to worry about this album because it's indulging the storytelling a little too much. I feel like we've had Happiness, Dorothea, and Coney Island, which are like very intense, vivid depictions of stories, and I'm getting a little lost. So I need something to orient me back into her life and understand how this fits into her perspective. And the next track is Ivy, so I'm not sure that I'm gonna get that, but let's see. I hope that this isn't Dorothea part 2. I really hope so. Pretty. In from the snow, your touch brought forth an incandescent glow, tarnished but so grand. I love vocals. Okay, I really like this. I really like this one, thank God. Go off, queen. Okay, I'm getting Illicit Affairs, I'm getting Secret vibes. Could be a queer element to it, I don't know, she'll never say. Oh, I love this. Tell us. Speak on it. This shit goes off. I'm obsessed. I loved that. I loved the vibe. I loved the energy. It felt relaxed. It felt natural. It didn't feel forced. There was something so interesting about the juxtaposing elements of the situation being really sad and kind of dastardly, and then the sound of the song being wistful and hopeful and longing, because that's what you feel when you're in love and you know that you shouldn't be. I am obsessed. Next up is Cowboy Like Me. I'm very excited for this song. I love Yeehaw Taylor. I love a country moment. I love the storytelling that happens when she sings a country song. So I am hoping that this is everything that I dreamt it to be. A bop, perhaps? And the tennis court was covered up with some tent-like thing. Okay. And you asked me to dance, but I said dancing is a dangerous game. Telling all the rich folks anything they want to feel like it could be love. I could be the way for it, only if they pay for it. That was interesting. It was a little convoluted. I'm not exactly sure what it was about. Actually, I have no idea what it was about, but there's a cowboy, she's like him, there are some pretty lyrics in there. This is not a standout track to me. It is a 40% snooze, but there are some interesting elements to it. Let's move on to track 12, which is, long story short, I think this is a hilarious title for a song because she has literally never made a long story short. It's always short story long. So let's see. Yes, a beat. Thank you, God. Okay, I'm so into this. Long story short, it was a bad guy or it was the wrong guy. I mean, this could be about so many fucking people. I think that this is about Calvin Harris because she's declined to go on the record in song and talk about him. And she's just continuing to do that by saying that it was a long story short, so.
Get lost in these petty things. Your nemesis will defeat themselves before you get the chance to swing. And he's passing by. Where is the glimmer of a comet in the sky? And he feels like home. The shoe fits, walking it everywhere you go.
Long story short, I survived. Okay, brilliance. Excellence. Never been done before. I forgot that you existed. This is what you wanted to do and were unable. I am obsessed with this song, how she's going back and talking to her past self. I love referential moments where she reaches back in time, and this is such a bittersweet kind of, I think, closure to that chapter of her life where we were all following along for the drama and the gossip and the details and the music. I think she's kind of like signaling to herself as she's getting older and to us that she's beyond that. She's got bigger things to focus on, like her impending marriage to a London boy, okay? Track 13, Marjorie. So this is about her grandmother, who was an opera singer. I have no expectations for the song. If she starts singing opera, I will throw myself out the window.
Never be so kind, you forget to be clever.
Good advice. Never be so clever, you forget to be kind.
Never be so clever, you forget to be kind.
I'm a fucking genius.
I think you were talking to me now.
I think this is a vocal sample of her grandmother singing. That was so beautiful and so poignant and so personal. And I lost a grandparent this year, so I completely understand that idea of feeling like there's some part of you that still contains them, or having something that's been passed down to them. And I think that the idea that her grandmother's aspirations to be a singer, because her grandmother was an opera singer, and her dreams still live in Taylor, is really sweet. And she articulated that so beautifully. Great, that's a highlight for me. All right, 14, Closure, something that she's never experienced. So I'm interested to hear her speak on it. We know this bitch never gets closure, so. What? Huh? Who? What's happening?
It wasn't right the way it all went down.
That's that's true about so many situations.
No, yes, I got your letter. Yes, I'm doing better. It could deep denoya right to the bone. Yes, I got your letter. Yes, I'm doing better. I know that it's over. I don't need your closure.
She said,
your closure. Fine with my spite and my tears and my beers and my candles. I can feel it. It's fake and it's also unnecessary.
It's fake and unnecessary. Did you hear that, Scott Borchetta? It's fake and unnecessary, so cease and desist. Okay, that was cool. I really like that. I like how she's addressing this very central conflict in her life right now through song. I think that this is a good response to Scott Borchetta. I feel like he probably reached out after he heard My Tears Ricochet and was like, damn, I really fucked up this bitch. And now she's being like, keep it to yourself. If you feel guilty about it, that's not my problem. I don't want to make things better. I just want to be angry and re-record my albums and be on some new shit, which is what she's doing. So I like that. I thought the production was really interesting, the way that it kind of like has a tape recorder feel coming into it. It was cool. All right, we're at the last track. I can't believe this. Evermore featuring Bon Iver. I hope this isn't a snooze to close out the album, but I have my suspicions. I'm wondering if this is a sequel to Exile or what. Okay.
Trying to find the one where I went wrong.
Okay, the vocals here are insane.
Writing letters, address to the fire.
Beautiful.
And I was catching my breath, staring out an open window, catching my death. And I couldn't be sure.
I like this a lot. This is not a snooze.
Can't remember what I used to fight for.
This again feels like a reflection on 2016.
Oh, can we just get a pause?
Kind of scary.
To be certain we'll be torn again. May the weather be the frost.
This is really giving me I Need a Forest Fire vibes, which is a Bon Iver song with James Blake. Listen to it, it's great, and this sounds like it.
The violence of the dark, in the cracks of light,
can we just get a pause?
I dreamed of you.
To be certain we'll be torn.
There's a lot going on. Much better than the collab with The National. I'm sorry. That was a letdown in retrospect. That was amazing. I think that's a really great bookend to the album, and I think it signifies kind of like a closure of this folklore chapter down these like dark and twisty roads. It definitely feels final and it feels like a conclusion of sorts. Daylight didn't have the range to be like this. It felt so forced, whereas Evermore is absolutely more encompassing and interesting and intriguing. I definitely need to dive into this album more and unpack it, but on a first listen, it's pretty good. It's not giving me the overwhelming shock that I got from Folklore. This is really interesting, and there are moments here that divulge from the Folklore narrative, but there are moments that lean back into it a little bit too much. There are some snoozes. Happiness, Dorothea, and Coney Island, I'm Looking at You, as a stretch of particularly boring songs. But I am pleasantly surprised at the variety on this album. I really liked No Body, No Crime. I liked Tis the Damn Season. Gold Rush was amazing. Ivy is good. Marjorie is good. Closure is good. I'm pleased. Over, across the board, I'm pretty happy. It definitely is Folklore side B. I don't think that this is like a completely separate work. It's kind of drawing out some conclusions from the first attempt, but I'm so pleased. Yeah. That's it for my reaction, though. I'm done. I need to go process all of this. But if you want more of these videos, subscribe, give me a thumbs up, go listen to my podcast, The Evolution of a Snake. My Instagram is ZachCityBish. I post about Taylor Swift. Come hang. All right. Goodbye. I'll see you the next time this happens, which will probably be in 3 months.